Sagar, can you please also enable the chat to everyone? Maybe that might help.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Okay, I guess we can start. So it's almost 10 a.m. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining this particular lecture. So today it's me and Anupritha. So both of us are going to talk to you about gravitational lensing, which is a fascinating subject on its own. It's not only informative, but it also leads to these very beautiful pictures that you can see in the sky. Okay, so we have been working on gravitational lensing for quite some time now. I previously talked about cosmology to you and a number of applications for cosmology or number of applications of gravitational lensing are useful for cosmology as well. Okay, so this time we are going to do something new. Okay, so as you saw from my email, we are not going to repeat the same set of lectures that we gave last year, but we want to try out something new, which is we asked you to go through the YouTube videos which we had already posted. And then we said that we are going to make ourselves available to any questions you may have about it, right? So we want this to be more of a discussion session rather than something us teaching you. So we are expecting you to have done some sort of a homework here, right? The way we are going through this particular aspect is that there were three set of lectures. So there was the first one, which was introduction to gravitational lensing. And then after that, the second lecture was things about strong gravitational lensing. And the third set of lecture was, or the third lecture was about weak gravitational lensing, right? So we will start with the introductory lecture first, the introduction to gravitational lensing, which tried to cover some of the basics of gravitational lensing itself, some of the equations, etc., and a little bit about the history of gravitational lensing. So if you have questions about this, based on the lecture that was presented last year and the links to which we had shared before, you could start to raise them in the chat. Or if you have questions, you can even raise your hands and let us know. So I have opened the first set of slides here. So if you look at the first set of slides, then anything regarding this first set of slides would be entertained, okay? And I'm happy to answer, right? Yeah, so I see Junik Sen Gupta. So I will ask you to unmute and please ask your question. Junik?
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, I can hear you now. Hi.
Thank you, sir. Sir, actually, I have a question from a year back, last time's lecture, and then I saw your videos and the lecture question again raised. Sir, my point is, as much as we know that the when we took look before the CMB perturbations, when all the matters and densities were eventually distributed, at that time, there was baryonic matter and dark matter were almost of equal composition. So is dark matter able to provide gravitational lensing? I mean, dark matter halos when they slowly gravitate towards
baryonic matter and dark matter are never in equal proportions, right? So it's roughly, if you look at the amount of matter in the universe, about 85% of it is dark matter. Okay, the rest of it is ordinary matter. Maybe given the order of magnitude, you said that they are roughly equal, and so that's what it is, right? And that proportion stays constant. Now, you can ask, okay, so given that 85% of the matter is dark, then what is it that causes gravitational lensing, right? So most of the gravitational lensing effect will be because of this dark matter, just because of the overwhelming proportion of dark matter in the universe.
The lenses that we are detecting today, the most of it is done by the dark matter.
It is most of the component of matter. That's why that happens. Is that okay?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So then, in the last lecture or in the last cosmology lecture, I had shown you these dark matter maps that you can make, right?
Yeah.
So that is done using this weak gravitational lensing phenomena. But when you make that map, most of the matter that you detect will be dark, just because that is what is out there, right?
Okay. And sir, actually, I have a second question, if I may ask.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, for example, suppose there is a galaxy which is causing gravitational lensing to another galaxy which is just beyond it. Now, suppose there is a gravitational wave which is passing through. What kind of effects will it cause to this lensing?
Right. So, gravitational waves are quite transient, right? And they happen on like millisecond time scales and so on, right? While these waves are traveling like forever, right? Huge distances of gigaparsecs and so on. So it's not going to cause like a huge effect on the electromagnetic radiation that is present, right?
So in that case, when a gravitational wave is passing through some kind of galaxy or some kind of source, when the lensing is occurring, it will not cause any serious effect in that.
No, I mean, these are like very millisecond levels, right? And if you look at the galaxy itself, for light to pass, I mean, these gravitational waves still have to pass through the galaxy, right? So if you take our own galaxy, the amount of time it takes to come from the center of the galaxy to us, right, is about 30,000 light years or 30,000 years, right? And so you can imagine these like millisecond kind of disturbances passing through the galaxy. It takes huge amount of time, right? And so it doesn't disturb the potential too much. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But you can see the strong lensing of gravitational waves, for example. Anuprita has been working on this kind of aspects where you can see gravitational wave sources which get strongly lensed, which means instead of coming like directly straight towards you, they take different paths. And then you can see the same event twice. Right. So that can happen. In fact, Anuprita is part of LIBE. Maybe you can explain.
So the gravitational, if the source is emitting gravitational waves, then you can see the same event happening multiple times. And if there is some electromagnetic counterpart, like you can see the emission from the host galaxy, then in the electromagnetic domain, if you're observing with optical telescopes or something, then you can see the lensed galaxy, the host galaxy being lensed. And then in the gravitational wave domain, you will be able to see the same event being appearing multiple times.
Right. So
which will be affected by some magnification factor. So
yeah.
And there is quite a bit effort happening in the LIGO collaboration to look for such lensing signals. And just recently we have put a paper on the archive which describes the various pipelines that are being used to search for lensing signals in the gravitational wave data. And so far, we have not found any signs of lensing. But people have considered various scenarios there, whether the lensing is affecting some of the brightest or the strongest events in a different way, whether there are some weaker events which are not detected as part of the confirmed gravitational wave events, but are there somewhere hiding in the data, whether they could be some of the multiple events due to lensing. So those kind of things are being searched, and so far there is no confirmed signs of lensing in the data.
So it takes it's a statistical thing, right? So you need to have this perfect alignment between the lens and the gravitational wave source. So the more and more events, gravitational wave events we see, then it is likely that that you will see lensed events as well. Okay, so let's take maybe another question. So Anik Srivastava. Thanks, Anik Srivastava, do you want to unmute yourself?
Okay, good morning, sir.
Hi, good morning.
Sir, my question is this, whether this gravitational lensing is commonplace or it is a rare phenomenon?
Right, yeah, that's a very good question, right?
Yeah, it is a rare phenomenon because, okay, you can say, you can think of it in different ways. If we only consider the weak effect, then it is everywhere, you would say, because any ray coming from a distant source, it will encounter in some direction, it will encounter some massive object or any object that has mass, and that will cause deflection in the direction of the rays. So in that sense, gravitational lensing is everywhere. But if we talk about the strong lensing effect, where the alignment is sufficiently well with the background source and the foreground object, in those highly aligned cases, you will see multiple images because the rays are able to converge from multiple directions. So that part of the lensing is rare because you need the observer, the intervening object, and also the background source to be aligned in a, you know, very small angle in the sky.
That's right.
So the strong lensing part is going to be rare.
It's quite rare, right? So you see some examples here on the screen of the strong lensing systems, right? So you see a big massive galaxy, which is at the center here. And then there is a background galaxy, which is behind this galaxy. And it is really very, very aligned. And then it turns into this kind of blue arc that you are seeing. Okay. So the original galaxy will be something simple looking,
like a spiral
galaxy, for example. And then because of this alignment, you instead get this kind of a mirage, right? Where that spiral galaxy now turns into this arc-like shape.
Okay. Sir, one more question. Whether this lensing somewhat related with the universe age or something, or it can we can determine something like that?
Yeah.
So because these in the case of strong lensing, because the light rays are coming from different directions, but because they are arriving at the observer from different directions, they are covering slightly different distances, and they are also experiencing slightly different gravitational potential of the intervening object. So because of that, one set of rays or the rays corresponding to one image will be arriving at, let's say, time t1, and the second image will arrive at time t2, and then there will be this time delay between those images. And because so with the help of these different time delays, if we can measure them, if the source is varying, then you can see fluctuations in the fluxes or the brightness of the image at one time, and then the same effect will appear at some after some time. And if you measure those time differences, then you can get constraints on the distances, the extra path that is being traveled by these rays. So through that distance measurement, then you can get constraints on some of the cosmological parameters. For example, the Hubble limitric constant. So you can get constrained on that, which is then inversely proportional to the age of the universe.
Right. Yeah. So these time delays that you get, right? Any times in the universe, they scale with 1/h0, right? And so if you can measure those time delays, then you get constraints on the Hubble limitric constant.
Okay, sir. Well, last question is just last question. Whether we can relate this lensing with the anisotropy also, because I don't know.
Lensing with anisotropy of what? Anisotropy of the universe?
Because we, as I say, that the universe looks flat, it looks anisotropic or homogeneous. So right. can they so, be like?
Yeah. So I mean, in principle, it does allow you, right? Lensing is going to map out matter in different locations, especially this big gravitational lensing phenomena. If that is the case, then if the universe was anisotropic, then in one direction you will find that the amount of matter fluctuations are different in one direction compared to the other, right? So this, in these kind of ways, you can put some constraints, I guess, on the anisotropy. If there are like large-scale gradients in the universe, then you may be able to figure that out. But large-scale surveys of gravitational lensing are yet to happen. So I think we have surveyed like hundreds of square degrees to thousands of square degrees. But the biggest survey that will happen for gravitational lensing will be from the ground, will be something like the Rubin Observatory's legacy survey for space and time. So that's one. Of course, the Planck satellite has given us a lensing map of the even further out universe, right? So redshift 3 or so. So that has given an all-sky map. So those kind of maps can be used in principle. If you look at anisotropies in the fluctuations.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Okay, so let's go to the next question. So, Chaitrali Shinde.
Hello.
Can we request people to lower their hands once their questions have been answered? Because I see some people who have answered, whose questions are answered, but their hands are still raised.
Yeah. So, Chaitrali, go ahead. You are very feeble. Can you speak a little bit louder? Sorry, it's very difficult to hear. So maybe you can write in the chat box and we'll take that question. Is that okay? Okay. So, Chaitrali, we are getting some background noise. Anik Srivastava, I'm going to mute. Okay, Abhijit Das, do you want to unmute yourself and ask your question?
Sir, I have a simple curiosity kind of a question. With all these space satellites, space telescopes, we could reach very deep. We are having very deep images of the universe. Sir, have we reached the limit of the observable universe? That is the first question. Okay, yeah. And if we have done that, then using gravitational lensing, maybe we can look, gravitational lensing gives us a view of the things beyond that, right? So, can that happen, that we can reach up to the limit of the universe, visible universe, and some gravitational lensing is happening, which is giving us a view of what is beyond that?
Right. So let's try to understand this question, okay, slowly and piece by piece, right? For gravitational lensing to happen, the photons from that location have still to arrive to us, right?
Yes, yes.
If the photons don't arrive to us, you cannot see the gravitational lensing, right?
Okay.
The farthest distance from which we have detected the photons are basically the cosmic microwave background, right? So that is when the universe was about 380,000 years old, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So now the age of the universe is 13.7 billion years old. At that time, the universe was 380,000 years old. So you can see how small a distance is remaining that we have not seen, right? Or yeah. I mean, that's the farthest that we have seen so far.
Okay.
So seeing anything beyond is even more difficult, because the photons that are there before that epoch, right, they were busy in this baryon photon fluid business, right? And so they are not something that, it's like a fog. You cannot see beyond that.
Yes, fog, yes, 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 yes.
Right? With photons. Okay? There may be other things like these cosmic neutrino background, etc., which allow you to go a little bit further out, right? But,
yes, yes.
But that's basically what it is, right? Also, gravitational lensing, I had mentioned in the slides, right? It is sensitive to matter which is roughly in between the distance from the source to us.
Yes.
And so it is not something, so if you have a source in the background, so like cosmic microwave background, is a wonderful backlight, right? And so if there is matter in between the cosmic microwave background and us, then that matter can be probed by the gravitational lensing of the cosmic microwave background. Okay, so the CMB itself, and I see one of the questions in the chat, is even CMB gravitationally lensed, right? And yes, indeed, we see, we have seen evidence of the gravitational lensing of CMB. In fact, that allows us to make a map of the dark matter at roughly a redshift of 2 or 3 by looking at the distortions that happen to the CMB because of lensing. Okay.
Thank you, sir. I understood. Actually, the scales are so high. The numbers are actually mind-boggling. So, to visualize and to compare, sometimes the questions become very stupid. Actually,
No. Nothing is a stupid question.
No.
I think this is perfectly fine. Okay. Unless you actually try to think about stupid questions, once you have those questions, then only you can try to say that, okay, it is good or not. Can I actually do this or not? Right? So it is perfectly fine. You have to think like a child, and it's fine. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Good. Thank you. Thanks. Okay. So then there is Rafi Adnan. Can you unmute yourself and ask your question? SM Rafi Adnan.
Yes, sir. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Good morning. Good morning, sir. So my question is that we can compare the whole gravitational lensing thing as like like optical lensing. We can compare with that. So if we can do that, my question is that when there is multiple like lens, like composite lens, when galaxy clusters like they're in the light from the galaxy comes and they scatter like they bend multiple times in like a composite lens. So how can we determine that which matter is causing that bending? I'm not making
no. I think yes,
dark matter or matter causes that bending, in which cluster does that mass belong to? How can we determine that?
So I think this is a very important and relevant question. And it is something that in the lensing community we are struggling with. So usually, we have this thin lens approximation where we say that, most of the matter which will cause lensing is going to be restricted to a small plane. But as you said, it's true that in reality, there are many lines of sight where there happens to be more structure in the direction to the background source. And one has to then consider deflections happening at each of those, let's say, lensing planes. So people have worked out the theory for that. In some situations, one can make certain approximations and consider those deflections being weak in some of those planes. So that is one way, depending on what is occurring in a given situation. So observationally, one can try to find out by spectroscopic observations, one can try to find out what are the additional objects which are in the line of sight by measuring their distances. And that way try to account for them when they're doing the lens modeling, trying to account for those structures in the line of sight. Sometimes the effect from these line of sight structures are strong enough that you can see much stronger effects on the lensed images themselves For example, if you are seeing some set of multiple images, then there could be the images that are created, they could be in such a fashion that you need to account for a very specific mass at a certain distance other than the lensing plane. In other cases, the lensed images will not show any strong effects. There will be small distortions, and those will have to be accounted for in a different way by assuming different structures in the line of sight. And you know, like if it is some dark matter clumps which are in the line of sight, this is of course going to be difficult because we will not know where exactly they are. But one can try to do this maybe in a statistical sense or by comparing with some like numerical simulations, which tell us typically how much matter will you see in certain lines of sight, and try to include those effects in a statistical manner. So there are different ways of handling this, and people are looking into this and trying to understand how this will affect the observables, the lens image observables, like their positions, their magnifications, their time delays. How will they be affected, and how we should take this into account?
Yeah. So I mean, sometimes what happens is these cosmological parameters or some things that you may derive from the lensing, then they can turn out to be biased if you don't fully account for some of these effects. So there's ongoing research in this field to try to understand. For most astrophysical situations, like if you, I mean, these kind of situations that she's talking about, are some of them are very, very special and rare, right? Where there are two lenses which you can directly see, right? And each of them is causing lensing. But then these weak effects and whether they can cause the Hubble constant to be slightly biased or not, those are things that are being considered currently. Okay, so let me take some from the chat as well. So there's one question. So this is from Yuvraj Murali Chandran. He's asking, by continuous analysis of a particular part of a space, like a time series analysis for gravitational lensing, can we find the dynamics of dark matter, right? So this is a good question. This goes into the heart of something called micro lensing. So in strong gravitational lensing, what happens is there is a background source, an intervening galaxy, and then us as observers. So there are multiple light rays which can come to us, right? And then that causes multiple images of that object. Now, these multiple images, they are separated by a certain distance. If that separation is smaller than the distances or the angles that you can resolve, then each of these images, they get merged and blended with each other, right? And instead, what you see is just like one image which has brightened, okay? Now, if the object causing that lensing is moving, or the source is moving with respect to that object, right, in the plane of the sky, then you will see that the magnification changes as a function of time. Okay, so this is called the micro lensing effect, where initially you see that it's a particular star. So it is more considered for more nearby objects, like stars in, say, Andromeda galaxy or stars in the Magellanic Cloud. And you try to imagine that there are some dark matter clumps which are moving in front of these stars, which are in the background, and then they cause these stars to get micro lensed. So what happens is these stars have some flux, and then they suddenly start to show a rise in their flux, and then it goes down. Okay, so it follows a certain particular curve. And if you look at that curve, then you can learn about the mass of this object, you can learn about the distance of this object, and maybe also the velocity of this object. So all these things are degenerate, but you can, if you have many, many statistical events, then you can put some constraints on the statistics of this distance distribution, the mass distribution, and the velocity distributions. Okay. So there's another question.
One more question that I would like to take from the chat right now is from Abhay Karnataki, and their question is, how to search for gravitational lensing phenomena? Can we use machine learning for the same? Yes, so gravitational lensing phenomena, like the strong lensing, is there are different methods that are used. Some methods depend on the nature of the background source. For example, if these are quasars, then you can specifically try to search for quasars and then identify the ones which may be lensed. Then the other method could be based on the foreground, which means whether the foreground is a galaxy or a galaxy cluster. Then the galaxy clusters, they are the number of galaxy clusters are much much fewer compared to the number of galaxies which act as lenses. Then we can use slightly different method there. We can start with a catalog of galaxy clusters and then try to identify which of them show signs of lensing, like these giant arcs around them. There could be different approaches there also, where you can directly do maybe visual inspection, or you can use some algorithms to identify elongated features, which are prominent enough in the data. You can also use multi-band information, means different filters in the optical or radio or any other telescope you may have data from. In addition to that, you can also look at spectroscopic data. In the spectroscopic data, you can find spectral features which correspond to objects which are closer to us and also farther from us. So because in strong lensing, in a very small line, within a very small angle, you are seeing emission from the foreground galaxy and also the background galaxy or a quasar, right? So when you take spectroscopic measurements, you will be able to detect features from a nearby object and also from a farther object within the same spectrum. So you will have a composite spectrum. And so you can use the understanding of what one expects to see in a spectrum for typical galaxies or quasars, elliptical galaxies versus spiral galaxies. You can use this understanding to infer which features are coming from the foreground and which are coming from the background, which also allows us to identify gravitationally lensed objects. And coming to the last part about machine learning, yes, people are using this technique to search for gravitational lenses. In most cases, again, they make use of multi-band imaging data. In most cases, the background sources, they appear bluer and elongated. There are these elongated features. And so with machine learning, we can use convolutional neural networks typically, which allows us to find these elongated arc-like features, which are bluer compared to the foreground galaxies. So mostly image-based machine learning approaches have been used. Some are also based on just the how bright the objects are, and you can use some catalogs to make you to determine whether certain features are being lensed or not. So there are multiple methods, and yes, machine learning approaches are being used, and you can find some of the references, or we can also share them with you if you would like to have those. Ongoing research. This is like very much happening right now, and people are trying to make lots of improvements in making the searches efficient.
Yeah. I mean, including ourselves. You know.
Yeah.
Let's see. Let's take a few more questions from the chat. So, Savan Shende asking, so once the background galaxy is lensed, then how do we get to know the actual shape and size of the background galaxy? Maybe you want to answer this, Pritham.
So the actual shape and size, with strong lensing, one of the information that you can make use of are the multiple images that you see. Also our prior knowledge of what a typical galaxy might look like, what their sizes might be given the distances. So there are many other galaxies which are at the same distance as our lensed galaxy, which is of our interest, right? There are many other galaxies which are of similar colors, of similar type, and at similar distances as the lensed galaxies. And so we can make use of the prior information that if it's a spiral galaxy, based on the colors, you can say that it's a spiral galaxy. You can also, based on the distances, there are already studies which tell us how what are the sizes of these galaxies at certain distances. There are many such relations that have been inferred based on other studies on galaxies. So we can use some of that prior knowledge, and then we can also we also know how to based on the theory of gravitational lensing, we know how to make models which when we try to fit to the observed data where we can see multiple images, that will allow us to infer what are the shapes and sizes of these galaxies. Of course, there are uncertainties on this because we don't have the perfect knowledge of how exactly the mass is distributed in the foreground lensing object. We may not have the exact understanding of how the background galaxies may look like. So there are uncertainties in these things, but we still have fairly good knowledge of how typical galaxies look like and how the masses are distributed in the foreground lenses. That allows us to get sufficiently good understanding of how to measure the shapes and sizes of these background galaxies. So that is through the understanding of theory of gravitational lensing, we can make mass models, we can make lensing models and try to predict how the images look like given the prior information of the background galaxies.
Yeah, so it is basically like looking like this, right? So you have these multiple lines of sight, right? You can see this image of a girl who is standing in front of these mirrors. So what you see is the distorted images.
Yeah.
And from this image and the shape of this mirror, you have to work out what the original girl looks like. Of course, in the case of these mirrors, you can actually feel what the shape is, right? For the gravitational lensing, so the lens objects which are acting as the lens, there you have to assume some prior information of what the density distribution might be, right? And then using that to see whether you can actually reproduce the observations or not, right? So it's a complicated inverse problem, but it is something that can be done, and there are papers which do this. Okay, multiple papers which you will see have done these kind of things, reconstruction, source reconstructions. So let's take the next question from Jyotirmay Pramanik. I'm going to ask him to unmute.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Sir, am I audible?
Yes, we can hear you.
My question is, suppose if the lensing body is not in spherical shape, suppose it is in flat shape, then how the shape and color of the image will be deformed from the source?
Sure, yeah. Strong lensing.
So the if I understood correctly, the question is if the foreground lensing object, if it is not spherical, if it has a different symmetry or it could be elliptical or something, then how that will affect the images, the lensed images? Is that
clear? And the source, yes.
Lensed images means the images of the background source. If we again go back to the theory of gravitational lensing, what we find is that depending on the symmetry, depending on the mass distribution, we can find different numbers of images and also the image configuration in which they appear. So the presence of ellipticity allows us to form additional images, and then apart from that, the morphology of the images can also be different, can also be altered, which then depends on the source, partly depends on the source properties, but mainly the numbers of images can be different.
Yeah, so spherically symmetric systems, for example, if you have a point source in the background, then it will give rise to two images. Okay. But if you add in some ellipticity, then there are certain regions of space. If the source lies in those locations, then it is possible that you will get a quad configuration where you find form like four images instead of just two. Okay. So these kind of differences do tell you something about how this spherical symmetry gets broken.
Yes, it means most of the cases, for suppose for nebula or something, so this means lensing body shape will be not spherical. It will be
Most of the times it is elliptical, and that's those are the kind of models that that get used.
And is the color of the image will also change?
No, so color will color not depend upon any of the cases of this of the shape of the lens distribution. Gravitational lensing is achromatic, so any wavelength, it will not get affected in some differential fashion. It, only when wave optics is important, then you start to see some of these differential magnification effects, frequency dependent effects, but otherwise you are okay.
Yeah, in theory, there is not going to be any difference at different wavelengths, at least if, let's say, if, suppose we just consider, let's say, optical range, wavelength range, then there's not going to be any significant difference going at, you know, different wavelengths. But what may happen, it's not because of lensing, but what may happen is that you may see some differences in the colors of the multiple images, or the appearance may look different, but those are due to other effects that the light rays are undergoing. Maybe some of the light rays are undergoing absorption, or they are scattered, or that, yeah, because like one of the images is experiencing different different amount of dust, let's say in the lensing galaxy. One of the images is much closer to the lensing galaxy and it is experiencing much much more amount of dust than it can get absorbed or scattered compared to the other image, you know. So that may create certain differences, but this is not related to lensing itself.
It's just the different paths, right? So one of the paths may be closer to the lens galaxy, another part a little bit further away. Then closer you go to the lensing galaxy, you may get more redden. Okay, good. So let's take another question. Maybe Chaitrali, if you want to try to unmute and see if we can hear you this time.
Hello?
Yeah, now we can hear you.
Yes. So my question is based upon the lectures, previous year's lecture. So while explaining about scale deflection angle, you talked about critical surface density, which helps us to understand geometry of the universe. So can you please elaborate on this, that what surface density, how surface density helps us to understand geometry of the universe?
Right, so there is this concept called a critical surface density, which, so let me try to find that particular thing. Here you come, right? So in the equations of the scale deflection angle, you get this particular term in the denominator, which is related to the geometry, right? Yes. So what is happening is, you see that there are angular diameter distances between us and the source, which is here ds, right? Then there is an angular diameter distance between us and the lens, which is this dd, which is here, and then between the lens and the source, which is this dds, which is here, right? So if you look at this particular quantity and you try to calculate what are the dimensions of this, then you will see that it will have dimensions of surface density. Okay. And so this surface density, it enters into all the equations of lensing, okay? Because it enters the scale deflection angle, so it enters these equations. And so if you can figure out what the, if you can figure out, say, what the lensing images are looking like, and you can figure out the properties, then you can work out what this critical surface density looks like. Typically what happens is you assume a particular model for your lens, right? And you try to fit it, given the spectroscopic redshifts and and the angular diameter distances in a fixed cosmology, then you can use that to figure out what the critical surface density is. Okay? But in certain cases, especially like the places where you have multiple sources in the background, okay, then you can use these multiple sources to then figure out the distance ratios, because now you don't have one source, you have two sources, right? So the any unknowns regarding the lensing potential, for example, they will drop out. And so you can create a distance ratios, right, of these angular diameter distances to different redshifts, okay, by using the image separations between these different sources. Okay, and so once you do that, then you can learn the angular diameter distance redshift relation, which again, then you, as you learn from the lectures of cosmology, you can use those relations in order to put constraints on the geometry of the universe or on the cosmological parameters themselves.
Yes, yes.
So that's how it works.
Yes.
Yeah, so this alpha, you can turn it into a quantity called Einstein radius. And this Einstein radius is observable. So if you have two sources which are getting lensed, then these two Einstein radii, you can take the ratio of these. I think Anuprita had explained this in her lectures once, I think, in the strong lensing part. So if you look at those lectures, you will see that you can try to learn about some distance ratios from them. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, I cut you off.
Yeah, yes. So my next question is, what is lensing potential and how does it help us to, what does it tell us about the lensing system?
Right, yeah. So this lensing potential is something which is related to, let's see if I have it in this particular, yeah, okay. So if you, so this is the equation where the lensing potential directly comes in, right? So if you try to work out what is the arrival time of any of the images, okay, then this arrival time of the images, it is given by this particular factor, right? So what you are asking is, what is the arrival time of images of a source which originally lies in a direction beta? But now, if the light ray from that source is coming to you from an angle theta, right? Then what is the arrival time of that particular light? Whether light will actually take that path or not, that's a separate question. But you can ask, okay, if this is the path that the light ray takes, then what is the time arrival of that particular light ray? How much time it will take to travel along that path? So that particular time is given by this particular equation. It's some sort of a scale time. So you'll have to put in all the C's and all these factors correctly there. Then it is half times theta minus beta the whole square, where theta is the position of the image that you are asking, and beta is the position of the source, the original source, right? And then there is a minus of psi of theta. So this particular psi of theta, that is called a lensing potential. So if you take this particular equation and then you take a gradient of it and equate it to zero, you will find that you get back the lensing deflection angle. That lensing deflection angle turns out to be the gradient of this lensing potential. Okay, so this lensing potential is something that you can just define from the equations of the deflection potential, of the deflection angle. In that deflection angle, you have a term which is like a vector divided by mod vector square, right? So that vector divided by mod vector square, you can write it down as a gradient of some natural logarithm of some quantity, okay? So that natural logarithm of that quantity is what is defined as the lensing potential, okay? So the gradient of that, it gives you this, the lens deflection angle. But the physical picture is that this particular lensing potential, it turns out to be important in calculating what is the time of arrival from the source to us along a particular path length. Okay.
Yes, sir. And so one more question. So when you talked about the time delay,
yeah,
you said that with the help of time delay, we can measure distances to the source or lens. But for that, how do we measure time delay?
Right. So for measuring the time delay, I guess I will hand over to Ankita. She will.
Yes. So I touched upon this earlier, which is that if the source is variable and there's some fluctuations happening, then and if you're lucky enough to monitor, observe the source at that time, then we can catch those fluctuations at one point of time. And then, you know, either we are lucky enough that we are also observing the those fluctuations in the second image at the right time, because it can be hours, days, months, years later. But one can have some understanding of that based on the lens modeling that you do, by having some information about their distances, the masses of the lens. We are able to predict what those time delays may be. But again, because of uncertainties in all these calculations, we may not have the exact answer, but we'll have some idea of what those scales are. And we can try to do those observations over those scales, time scales, you know, whether it's hours or days or weeks. If we continuously monitor, then we can measure those time delays, catch the fluctuations happening. Sometimes, if you have the background quasar, background source is a quasar, then there is some variability which is there, you know, all throughout. But sometimes there are like sudden changes that are happening, which will allow you to capture those or identify them much more accurately. And if we can track those things by continuous monitoring over a long time scale, then you can identify those. In those multiple images, you can identify the same features appearing, and that way allows us to measure those time delays.
I mean, one of the interesting cases that had happened, for example, just recently is there was a supernova which got lensed in a cluster, okay, in a galaxy cluster. And then it could be accurately predicted as to when the next arrival of the supernova image will happen, okay? Just based on the model of the galaxy cluster, right? So you can do these kind of predictions, and then when you observe them, then those time delays then help you further. Like the accuracy of this time delay measurement is good. Then you can use that information to then further constrain your model better. Okay.
Okay. One last question to ma'am from the second lecture, where you talked about number of images that can form depending upon distance between source and lens. As the source approaches near to the lens, number of images increases, and at the center you said 5 images can be formed. So what is the maximum number of images that have been observed till now for lensing, or is it at most we can observe 5 images for any lensing system?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So if we are looking at some of the typical mass distributions, simpler mass distributions that have been worked out, let's say for individual galaxies, then in those cases, as far as I know, it's going to be maximum is going to be 5 number of images. But when we are considering more complex mass distributions, when we are departing from this isothermal elliptical profiles, especially like when you're looking at galaxy clusters, where there is a complicated mass distribution because of multiple satellite galaxies, or there could be in other galaxy clusters or galaxy groups in the line of sight. So because of this very complicated mass distribution, it can happen that one is seeing more than the standard number of images. It is in that sense, it won't be uncommon. But even for galaxy cluster, it can happen that, you know, the overall mass distribution is still fairly standard, and one sees the typical set of image configurations and so on. There are many interesting situations happening in the galaxy clusters. For example, you will see one arc and then a counter image of that arc. But what happens is that this one arc will fall very close to a satellite galaxy. Then that one arc, a part of that arc will be multiply imaged, and you will see a counter image of that small set of that arc because the satellite galaxy is so close to that one of the arcs. So then these kind of things happen. Yeah. So one cannot exactly...
there is no maximum number as such, right?
There is no maximum number as such.
You can have as many as you want. There is
it will all depend on how complex the mass distribution and where the source falls on that complicated set of caustics.
Right. Yeah. So the supernova that I talked about, there were many, many images that formed actually. So there's like 4 images, but then there was the galaxy in which the supernova happened, that is getting lensed, right? That has gotten lensed multiple times, right? So the supernova will occur in each of these images. And in one of these image, that was near a satellite galaxy. So that got again further multiply image into 4, right? So you can take a look at this gravitationally lensed supernova.
It's called SN Refsdal.
Supernova Refsdal.
Supernova Refsdal, REFSDAL. So if you search for this, you will find this really interesting system.
It is quite interesting, right? Yeah. The first image in this of the supernova, that should have happened like decades ago or something,
like
in the 1990s.
50-60 years ago or something.
Was it 50? Okay. So,
something like that.
Quite a few decades ago. Okay, let's put it that way. And then, of course, no one was observing that system at that time. So that supernova is born. But then now, serendipitously, one of these images were found to have this supernova. And then it was predicted when the next image will happen, etc. So you can follow the history. It is quite interesting. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, thanks. So let's see. So there was this question about the Psi-11. So this is about the lensing potential. Right. So this particular Psi is actually a scalar field, but then you can take the derivatives of this scalar field, right? And so the Psi-11 is the second derivative. So it's like del Psi in the first direction, and then again taking another derivative of that, okay? So this Psi, 11 is this second order derivative. So these particular aspects, they come in when you try to look at the magnification matrix. Right. So this magnification matrix is this del beta I by del theta j. So in this particular, remember beta is the position of the source, the original source, and that will be two dimensional because you're looking at the position of the source in the plane of the sky. Similarly, the position of the image will be two dimensional. And so theta, which is the position of the image, that also has two vectors. And so you can take a derivative of del beta I by del theta j. So you can take beta in one direction, but the derivative along the other direction, right? So when you do that, then you will see that in the expression for this del beta by del theta, which tells you something about the magnification, you will have the second derivative of the lensing potential. And this happens because you actually have the first derivative of the deflection angle. And deflection angle itself is a derivative of the potential. So that's why you get this double derivatives. Okay. And so that's the reason why you have this Psi-11, which comes out, which is written, which goes into the components of this magnification matrix. Okay. So this is just the mathematics of it. You will be able to follow it if you just work through it one by one.
Maybe we can take one last
question. Let's take one last question.
So there is one question from Bhuneshwari Kashi. Will every wave or frequency undergo bending due to the curvature, or is it only the light? Yeah, so the quick and short answer for that is that at any waves, like whether it is electromagnetic light or gravitational waves or anything else, you can see the effect of lensing. It will depend on the scale of the wavelengths and also the scale of the lensing object itself. If the waves are comparable to the size of the lensing object, then you can see the lensing effect. And the lensing effect can be also different. If the lenses are going to be much shorter than the scale of the lensing object. But the short answer is that you
all
will
these
see,
electromagnetic waves.
You will see the lensing effect at all wavelengths.
Right.
And not just limited to electromagnetic light.
Yeah. Okay, so we are coming close. Maybe we can take just one more question, and then after that we will end. If you have more and more of the questions like these coming, then we could even think about having another session. That's not a problem, because there's some other telcons and so on which are coming up, so we will have to take care of that, right? So maybe what we can do is, I see that there are still like many new messages which are coming up, so how about you hold these questions and we will set up one more lecture, one more discussion session with you, so that we can get all these questions from you and then answer them. Is that okay? I hope that will be fine. Okay, so thanks a lot for attending today's discussion session. We will try to organize one more of this. Please let us know if you have any feedback, at least let the organizers know if you have any feedback regarding whether you found this kind of session useful, whether it was okay for you to do it in this particular manner when it goes on, because now we can get more and more of your questions. But again, of course, it involves this extra burden that you have to first go through our previous lectures, right? So given that we are in this situation, please let us know what you think of this so that we can arrange more of this. Okay. Thank you so much. So we'll end here. Okay. Thanks.